All right, we're heading into a presidential election cycle, and just as is with the previous story in the first segment, it's important to understand what people believe, even if you don't believe it. Now, here's where we put our big boy pants on and say, hey, we're adults. So even if we talk about something you don't believe, you still live in a world full of other people. Now, other people believe other things than you do, and when you're electing them, it's important to understand what other people believe, because that belief system is going to impact how they live their life and the decisions they make. And remember, we taught this before, a belief is an accepted truth. It doesn't even always have to be fact. It just has to be an accepted truth. So because of that, I wanted to take an opportunity to look at one of the front runners for president and his belief system. Mitt Romney is a Mormon. That's not a secret. I mean, Glenn Beck has been making sure nobody thinks that that's a secret. So I wanted to bring up the idea of Mormonism. Now, I'm not a Mormon, so this is not me trying to promote my views or anything like that, but I, like you, want to understand what other people believe. So we went out and we got an expert. His name is Ed Decker. He's the man behind the Decker Report. He spent decades in the Mormon Church. Past tense. He spent decades in the Mormon Church. So he has a lot to say about this subject. Ed Decker, welcome to the show. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. Good to be here.
Well, it's a pleasure having you. Now, Mormonism is one of these things that a lot of us haven't really took the time to understand. I mean, the closest I've come to Mormonism is people I've known or worked with or whatever, you know. I've never studied it. So let's just start with that. What is Mormonism?
Well, first you got to understand that there's, you know, the Mormons are great people that, you know, when we're talking about today, has nothing to do with, you know, people and attitudes. We're talking about doctrines and people's belief systems more than we are people, because Mormons are good neighbors. They're good citizens. You know, I don't want anybody to think that we're here bashing Mormons today, but what I do want to tell you is a little bit about Mormonism. Mormonism is uniquely an American religion. It began in the 1800s. A young man claimed that he went out to a grove of trees and prayed during a lot of religious revivalism going on upstate New York area and Vermont and that whole area. And he went out to a grove of trees and prayed and asked God which church he should join. And he says that God came down physically along with his son Jesus Christ, and they told him to join none of the churches, that their creeds and teachings were abominable or filthy in the eyes of God, and that all the creeds that they professed were corrupt, and all those who taught it were corrupt people. And so that he must sit back, and God was going to reveal and restore the true gospel through him, this young man. And so he went home, and he waited, and then one day an angel came into his room. The angel Moroni came into his room in a shaft of light and told him where a chest was in a mountain called the Hill Cumorah, which it wasn't much of a mountain, but it was what they called the Hill Cumorah in Palmyra, New York. And in that chest was a set of gold plates, a book written on gold plates in Egyptian. And the young man was to go there 4 years in a row and visit these plates before the angel would let him take them out. When he took them out, he then translated them by using a thing that was in the chest called the Urim and Thummim, and he put the Urim and Thummim in a big hat like Lincoln wore, stuck his head in there, and his scribe sat next to him on a table with the plates, and through the power of the Urim and Thummim, Joseph Smith, the first prophet of Mormonism, translated the Egyptian scrawlings on those. And long story short, when they were done, the angel had him come and take the plates and go into a secret cave in that same area and place them on a table in the cave, and then the cave shut down and disappeared, and that's why nobody could see the plates. That was the beginning of Mormonism. And that has now grown into about 14 million people worldwide. They believe that God is a man, a physical man, and that he grew up on another planet as I guess, a Mormon there, believing and teaching and studying and being righteous to the gospel of the Mormonism at that planet. And when he died and was resurrected, he was made a god, given many goddess wives, brought to a planet in our solar system, or just outside our solar system, because nobody can tell you where that is, but it's a planet near the great star Kolob, the Mormon scripture says. And there, he and his thousands of goddess wives have made babies that were spirit babies, who then come to the earth to gain bodies so they can try and be studied and work to become gods themselves like he is. That's the basis of it.
Okay, I got to tell you, right off the offset, other than the two words Jesus Christ, none of that really sounds like mainline Christianity. Not and again, not to insult Mormons. I think you made a great point in saying, you know, this has nothing to do with insulting the people. Every Mormon I know seems to be a really great person, and they rock the family values. So this isn't against individuals. So I want to make that clear, because, you know, your mama always told you don't talk about politics, religion, and money, and we don't want to offend, you know. So anyway.
And here we are doing it.
Here we are doing it. It's funny how the world works out, isn't
it? I'm sorry, Mom.
Well, if that's the case, Ed, I have to apologize every day, because that's how I make my living. But anyway, so we have this faith that is saying, you know, Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And other than the word Jesus Christ, like I said, none of this really sounds Christian. And I don't mean that to be, you know, divisive, but is this really Christian?
Well, what it sounds like is a plot for the Battlestar Galactica. In fact, many Mormons worked on that program. That's why I remember it when I was a Mormon. But the funny part about it is that the people who believe in this feel it necessary that they have to earn their own godhood. The Jesus of Mormonism is not the Jesus of the Bible, even though, and that's the trick with a lot of groups that are sort of pseudo-Christian groups. So they use the same words, but they have the same meanings. You know, the Jehovah's Witnesses are obviously the same way, but their Jesus was born on the planet near the great star Kolob to God Elohim and one of his goddess wives. His brother, his literal brother, was Lucifer. And then when it came time for God to populate this earth and to set a program up here so that people can become gods, it's sort of like a spiritual Amway program, if you think about it. And what you had is then was a council of the great gods, gathering together, and then the god Elohim on the planet near the great star Kolob brought his two sons, Jesus and Lucifer, and to present their plans for the earth, although they've never been on one, even though God was. And
interesting.
They...
Hold on 1 second, sir. We're up against a break. We'll continue this right after the break. Don't go anywhere, folks.
But Josh, why do I care about this? I'm an atheist, or I'm a Buddhist. I'm not a Mormon.
Look, somebody is running for the highest office in the land, and they have a belief system. If there was a Buddhist running for office, I would want to understand what they believed, wouldn't you? See, it's called being an adult. When I said that we were going to do a show like this, Josh, stop bringing religion into the conversation. And, you know, it's always made, those statements are always made by people who have no religion, so they don't understand why religion plays an important role in people's lives. Hence, you don't understand why it's important to make sure you understand what your president is going to use as a belief system. And if you want to have this belief system, you know what? That's up to you. I mean, you can have it if you want to, but I want to make sure that we take the appropriate time to examine it, look at it, and see if it's really something that you align yourself with. So we're talking to Ed Decker, Decker Report. Let's get back into it. Now, you kind of gave us a sum-up version of what a Mormonism is, and I got to tell you, a lot of it sounds a lot like, well, honestly, a lot like Scientology. You know, there's a planet someplace else, that's where everybody came from. And Scientology is an American religion as well, created by a science fiction writer, Edward Griffin. Or no. His name escapes me right now. The Dianetics guy. Ed, do you know who I'm talking about?
Whoa.
L. Ron Hubbard. So we have these uniquely American religions that kind of have some weird similarities. Is it wrong to say that Mormonism isn't Christianity? Because I know that used to be said in the last presidential election cycle. This presidential election cycle, everybody's saying it is. And a lot of us who don't spend our day, you know, studying other people's theology are sitting here wondering, well, is it or isn't it? Did we lose Ed? Ed Decker, are you still with us? You know what? We may have lost Ed for a minute. Don's going to work hard to get him back. Don, you do such a great job on this show. Everybody give Don a round of applause. It's radio, folks. I'm kidding. He can't see you. But there does seem to be this bridge of similarity between, you know, American-created religions, both Scientology and Mormonism. They both have a planet floating out in some other land someplace, and everybody's a god. Ed, I think we have you back. Are you back with us?
I'm back on a cell phone because my other phone went dead on me.
You know what? That has a tendency to happen on this show. I don't know what's the deal with that, but welcome. What we were getting to is this idea of 4 years ago when we saw Mitt Romney running for office. Conservative media was telling us, well, this really isn't Christianity. Now, fast forward 4 years later, everybody's telling us it really is. And those of us who aren't professional theologians are sitting here wondering, well, is it or isn't it?
Well, it's not Christianity, and I think that I have a website that I deal with this subject on, and my own radio show and talk about it, and I've gotten probably in the last couple of days when I've been talking about who to vote for, I've been getting hundreds of emails of people who are Christians who are very upset. The issue isn't so much right now Mitt Romney's religion as it is what they can do to get rid of Obama. And so they say that if you don't vote for Mitt Romney, it's a vote for Obama. So what do you do? My point of it is that it's a Christless faith, that if you are a Mormon, you're serving a Jesus who didn't die for you and your sins. He died that you might be physically resurrected so that you can be judged for your works. That's why the Mormons work so hard at being good. Because only the good get to go to celestial glory and become gods and goddesses in Mormonism. And so the Mormon situation is kind of pushed off to the side. It's more expedient for people to get rid of President Obama and his regime than it is to worry about somebody who thinks that they're going to become a god.
Well, I want to get into how Mitt Romney's faith is going to affect his leadership in the next segment, but I kind of want to hit some of the basic pillars that I see, at least, as differences. If you are somebody of a Christian Judeo faith, you have some pillars that are found in both the Old Testament and the New Testament that kind of run contradictory to what we find in the Book of Mormon. One that comes from the New Testament is when Jesus says he's going to come back again. He gives us kind of an answer, doesn't he? He says, the next time you see me, I'm going to descend on the same place I went up from. And last time I checked, that place was not New York.
Well, he's not going to come back in Mormonism. He's going to come back to Independence, Missouri. There, when it becomes imminent that he's going to return, the Mormons, I have an article, in fact, it's a chapter of a book that I've written. It's called The Mormon Plan for America and the Rise of Mitt Romney, and that is free available on my website, saintsalive.com. In that particular article, I go into the fact that the Mormons believe that the Constitution will hang by a thread in the last days. A leader from Mormonism would raise it up, that the Mormon elders or the Mormon priesthood will save the nation and prepare for the coming of Jesus Christ, who will come to the New Jerusalem in Independence, Missouri. They'll build a great temple there. When the temple's done, he will come and preside over the millennial reign, and the Mormons will run the millennial reign in what I can only say is a theocratic form of communistic government.
Well, that's not too encouraging.
No, well, I mean, while we sit watching our Constitution get ripped up right now, you know, you think, boy, So that's what the goal is. They believe, in fact, there's a temple on the Beltway in Washington, D.C., a beautiful building, the Mormon Temple. The Mormon temples aren't places of worship. They're where you go and you go through rituals to learn how to learn the secret signs, handshakes, secret words, passwords, penalties, and swear oaths of obedience and so forth. And have special secret names given and things like that. And there you prepare so that you know how to get past the sentinels and have all the secret signs and handshakes and words and so forth that will allow you to enter the celestial glory. So it's a place where you learn how to get the secret combination to go enter into becoming your own God. That's what the Mormon temples are. However, the temple in Washington, D.C., the upper floor is prepared for the coming reign of the millennial Mormonism, where the prophet of the Mormon Church will preside over America out of that top floor. It's sort of like the Oval Office of the prophet. That's where he will reign. And that's kind of scary stuff when you think that you have that mentality built into you over the generations, as Mitt Romney has.
Well, that's very scary stuff, and it kind of gives you chills. It's almost like the, it's almost like a Nicolas Cage movie, you know, where some evil plot is being carried out in D.C. and then they're going to usurp the Constitution or whatever. Doesn't the Bible warn against things like, you know, restricted wisdom, using secrets and passwords and stuff like that? Isn't that the antithesis of what the Christian faith really is?
Well, it says do nothing in secret. Those things that are done and whispered in the ear, and that's what I did when I was a Mormon, standing at the Mormon celestial veil with my sacred undergarments on underneath my temple clothes, and on my garments were the square, the compass, and the rule of Freemasonry that were sewn into my undergarment. And interesting enough, the guy on the other side of the veil, portraying God, the Lord, has the same markings, and then I go there, and there's slits in the veil, and I put my arms through those up to the armpits, and I go foot to foot and knee to knee and breast to breast and hand to back and mouth to ear, and I say, health in the navel, marrow in the bones, strength in the loins and the sinews, power of the priesthood to be upon me and upon my generation, so forth and so on. And then he says, you know, I give him all the secret handshakes and everything else. While I'm at that same place, and to prove that I know how to get into heaven, and then he lets me slip through the veil.
Wow, that, you know, the more you talk about this religion, the more it sounds like something that the God of the Bible actually came to destroy. But we're going to get to that, and specifically Mitt Romney, right after this. Don't go anywhere. All right, so Mormonism is not the same as Christianity. And if you don't believe any of these things, that's, you know, you have the freedom to make your own decisions. You have free will. We're not trying to tell you what to believe. We're just informing you as to what other people believe. So if you are going to make a decision, you know, going into the decision process, what the people you are selecting believe. And it's very important. So, Ed, let's kind of transition into that. We have a religion where It sounds a lot like Scientology, or like you said, Battlestar Galactica. We have a situation where Jesus is evidently Lucifer's brother. We all become gods and populate Earths. The whole, basically, the entire Bible is nullified by the Book of Mormon because they so contradict each other, it's not even funny. How does this affect Mitt Romney? I mean, is he one of these guys who believes that he's supposed to occupy this Mormon Oval Office up in this temple? Is he somebody who's going to bring his Mormon faith into leadership, even though he says it's not going to affect it?
Well, he's a nice guy. He is a multi-generational Mormon. And of course, he comes out of the polygamous background of Mormonism. He's not a polygamist. Neither was his father, but they came. They were living. The Romneys, in fact, still do live down in Mexico. In a Mormon community there, where they fled the United States when polygamy was outlawed. They were among the families that fled to Mexico. They fought in the Mexican wars and everything else. They were, you know, they are Mexican citizens, many of them, well, obviously today. And so he comes from that background of years and years and years of following the prophet. Now, he went into the Mormon temple, swore oaths of obedience of everything he has, everything he owns, everything he will ever have, to obey the prophet of the Mormon church above any other man, any other thing on earth, everything he owns, everything he will have. And because he has been a poster boy Mormon, going on that rite of passage, going on a missionary trip for 2 years, he's done all the right things, was a bishop, was over above other bishops and so forth in the church, a leader, wealthy, earned his way, hardworking, of course, he wasn't a poor kid. He came out of a well-to-do family. So he's got all the credentials, and he looks good. He speaks good. He's soft-spoken. It's almost like if you took all the levels of Mormonism and you took the local people and the bishop and the so forth, you begin to add these people up. They have almost physical attributes that the higher you go up in that hierarchy, the more soft-spoken, the bearing and so forth changes. And he has all those characteristics. He is 100% fully, completely a temple Mormon on his way to godhood, and part of it is becoming the president of the United States.
Now, what about those Mormons out there who say, see, this is the fulfillment of prophecy. This proves that the Mormon church is true because the Constitution is in tatters, and here comes a Mormon who is going to save us from this. Aren't there cases where people are using this candidacy as an opportunity to spread the religion?
Well, certainly, and if you Google Mitt Romney, you'll also, when the Google stuff pops up, you'll also find ads for the Mormon church. They are now using this, and they are working. I have a Google search program that pulls up everything about Mormonism and the LDS church and so forth and Romney every day, and I'm looking at it, and it is they have, you know, millions of dollars set aside for advertising right now to make Mormonism as Christian as possible, even though they curse Christianity from the beginning, when the Mormon God said all the creeds were filthy in his eyes, all Christianity is corrupt. And when I went to the Mormon temple myself, I have that experience in my background. When I went to the Mormon temple, we learned from Lucifer that all the Christian pastors were hirelings of him. In fact, in the Mormon temple, when we are in the lone and dreary world and the Garden of Eden world and places like that, it's Lucifer who's doing the teaching, and he's wearing what I would call a past worshipful master's Masonic apron. And Adam asks him what that apron is, and he points to the square of the compass and the rule of Freemasonry that's on. He said, these are the emblems of my power and my priesthood. And I'm thinking, you know, I didn't think it then, but one day I discovered, hey, those are the same markings on my undergarment, on my sacred garment, my secret underwear that I wear, and it's got the square, the compass, and the rule. The markings of Satan are on there. They're in the veil. They're on the guy that I'm holding as the Lord. He's got them on him, and Lucifer says, if you fail any single one of the laws that you swore to today in this temple, you'll be in my power forever. You know, I mean, the warnings are all over the place, and that's the stuff that guys like Romney are playing with, but the Mormon church is trying to hide, and therefore I tell people.
This is freaky. Now, is this stuff that your average neighbor Mormon would know? I mean, do most Mormons know this?
First off, only about 35% of all the Mormons in the world actually become worthy enough to go into the temple and learn these things. 65% of the Mormons aren't worthy enough to get into the temple, and so what I saw in Mormonism was an elitism. We who made it to the temple, we were the elite. We were the wonderful people. We were the worthy ones, and these other people, either guilty or striving and failing, and you know, maybe having a cigarette or drinking a Coke. Well, now the Mormon Church says Coca-Cola's okay. You know, well, why didn't they say that when I wanted Coca-Cola, when I was a Mormon for 20
years?
Well,
they always seem to change what is and what is not considered a sin, and that's red flag number one. And then the whole approach to how you recover from sin is red flag number two. There seems to be a lot of unnecessary guilt placed on people, especially when you're a sinner by default. Is it fair to say that because most Mormons who are Mormons will never understand the true underpinnings of their faith, that this is really just a mainstream version of a Masonic or Illuminati church?
Yes, it is, because, again, every single blood oath that I swore to have my throat slit from ear to ear, to have my chest ripped open and my heart ripped out, or to have my belly ripped open and my bowels and my intestines spewed on the ground, every one of those oaths is from the Blue Lodge Freemasonry, in which the first five presidents of the Mormon Church were involved. Now, when they were in Nauvoo, Illinois, and they became the largest Masonic lodge in the state, in the district, and they were not doing what the Masons wanted. They lost their charter, and they were called a clandestine lodge. And that's when they began to do the same stuff in the Mormon temple, same identical stuff, same spiritual darkness, same garbage that Masons do in the oaths and the secret handshakes and everything else. It's crazy. I was in a business situation in my personal life just recently, and I went in to meet with a person I had to talk business with, and he tried to give me a Masonic handshake. I didn't bite it, but I thought, you know, if he wanted to know if I was a Mason, that depending on how he was going to treat me. Well, it's the same thing with Mormons. You know, they take care of their own, and that's the thing that you're going to see if and when Romney becomes president. You're going to see the walls, you know, spread out and more Mormons coming in. Right now, they have a huge investment in the CIA, the FBI, and the Secret Service, and the Mormon Church itself has over 500-600 security people who are mostly coming out of police departments and the Secret Service, CIA, and the FBI. What church needs five, 600 high-level security people?
Well, it sounds like a private little Gestapo army or, you know, something like that. And, you know, what's really freaky here is even as we're doing this conversation, atheists are calling in and texting in and following us on Facebook and Twitter saying that, you know, this is absolutely fascinating because it does matter. Even if you don't believe in anything, it's very important to understand what other people believe. And recently we saw Nicki Minaj, who many people think is a Illuminati Freemason sellout, kind of endorse Mitt Romney, who, again, if everything you're saying is true, is sort of a Freemason Illuminati sellout as well. And you start putting these strings together and it starts making a pattern, doesn't it?
It really does. And I was, when I had recently come out of Mormonism, was speaking at a Baptist church and sharing what I did in the temple. At the end of the service, I went to the back and was saying goodbye to people. One of the deacons or elders of the church got me off the side and told me to keep my mouth shut, that I was revealing secrets of the lodge while I was up there. And I said, I wasn't revealing the secrets of the lodge. I was talking about Mormonism.
So this is actually infiltrating other churches and mainstream quote-unquote Christianity as well?
Absolutely.
Oh, this is scary. All right. SaintsAlive.com, Ed Decker, Decker Reports. We're going to have you back, I promise, because, man, this is more tangled webs we weave when first we practice to deceive. We'll be back right after this.